This is Strange Love, After Hours. I'm your host, Cami Chaos. Welcome, babies. Good evening and welcome to Strange Love Live After Hours. I'm Cami Chaos, still. We're still with Dr. Normal.
Not so fast.
I'm sorry. Am I working too fast for your little
fingers? Yeah, I'm switching your lower thirds here. Well, maybe, this is new.
Maybe you have too many lower thirds.
All right, look.
Okay. So are you forgetting your job now?
Wait, here's
you
the
have
date.
A job in after hours.
Here's the date.
This it's is where it becomes evident that we're a couple.
Wait a minute. Yeah. And here's Cami Chaos, right?
That's me. Yay,
okay, we allow Cami a little time. And then you say, and now introducing.
And as always, Dr. Normal.
Hey, everybody.
There you go.
Oh, God. It's so cheesy. And see, I made my lower third.
This is what the kids love.
This is what the kids love. We're here tonight with Tad. Help me out here.
Lukasik.
Tad.
I think you
Tad
had it, though.
Lukasik and yes. Steve Galen.
Correct.
Yay.
Thank you.
Good job introducing the guests, Dr. Normal. It's not as easy
we
as I
have
make
to
it
do
look.
This
it.
Again.
Oh, it's so smooth.
We don't have to do this again.
I thought you liked having a job. Dr. Normal works very hard.
It's really hard to explain. But you keep going faster and faster and faster.
I know, because I'm so excited that you're going to introduce somebody.
And I'm waiting for you to ask me five questions in a row again.
It's entertainment.
I will.
See,
it's
entertainment. There's buttons down here that I have to push.
Before we go any further, there was a clarification. There was something we didn't get to talk about in the tech edition, which was the software developer's role in the creative industry.
Yeah, so we were talking about Oregon Creative Industries and the creative industries umbrella, and there's verticals within that, and this comes from different definitions.
I learned so many interesting terms this evening.
Yeah, new terms and new acronyms, and there's different sources for where the definition of what creative industries is and what verticals are within that. The primary Tad in the show mentioned the UK based, there's a government agency.
Yeah, DCMS.
What's it stand for?
Yeah. Department of Culture and Media and Sports or something.
Sounds like a police agency.
Yeah, so it's a UK.
DCMS.
But interesting, I mean, the UK government is ahead of us in recognizing the economic value of these industries and organizing them and putting numbers out there, you know, putting the research and the numbers out there so it recognizes an industry. Mm-hmm. And they have what they call their demarcation of what's in the industry and what's not. If you look at the Wikipedia entry, it picks up on that and then adds some things. And software is definitely in there. So my first job near the end of college and after college, I was writing code. That was my first gig. And I was also a musician. That was my other gig. And so I knew that, you know, writing code was a creative. I learned it from the beginning that writing code is a creative process. And that you know, good code writers are artists. Mm-hmm. And so I fully support this idea of having software in there. And so that's, you know, Oregon Creative Industries, that's been part of our outreach to these association verticals that representing different industries is Software Association of Oregon and Legion of Tech. So,
yeah. And again, about 14 of those. And the DCMS, Wikipedia is DCMS based. That's where everybody kind of goes. They kind of coined the term in 1998 for that category, so they claim.
Okay, I want to go back to the SEO and the Legion of Tech in just a second.
Yes.
But I want to ask, before we go any further, knowing that there are at least two musicians in this room, is there a musical
speaker or vertical?
Vertical,
music production and performance. Go ahead.
Yeah, it involves the Oregon Media Production Association, and within that is a lot of the categories, which is music production, radio, TV, interactive gaming. There's some things that don't fall in the computer category that fall in that one.
Okay.
That's actually one of the bigger ones.
Kind of a broader...
bigger cluster, yes, the broader-based one.
Cluster.
That can be narrowed down to one thing, like creative media production, for example, would encompass all of that.
But we had this Oregon Creative Industries hosted two... what we called Association Leadership Roundtable meetings in December and January, December 08, January 09. And within those verticals, we invited the Musicians Union and the folks, the local chapter of the Grammys, Musicians Union showed up. The Grammys folks didn't. They were going to, and then they didn't show up. But so, yeah, definitely music. And so it's performance arts. And music production, so that's all. Definitely
yeah, there's a fair amount of the associations, you know, throw out some acronyms, you know, with that. You can just go to our one sheet or something for all that, because there's 55 or 60 of them that swim around in my head all the time. You know,
what's wrong with him?
I get acronyms confused all the time. I'll be talking to Dr. Normal about something, and I'll use an acronym, and he'll be following me and think I'm talking about what something. I actually said, and I'm thinking about something that's a completely different three-letter acronym.
Right, yeah.
And then he all of a sudden, wait, that has nothing to do with ABC. I'm right, like, yeah. Well, no, it does. It does. He doesn't even know what I'm talking about.
I get a bad time about the acronyms from one of our revenue partners, you know, because it's like OBDD, PDC, OMHF, AIA, PA. I mean, AIGA.
There's a lot of freaking acronyms in the world.
Yes. Yeah. There's,
and I did notice how smoothly you worked that one in there.
Yeah.
Yeah,
okay,
no.
That was it for that one.
There's some history there.
The journey.
We have the
value
lovely
the journey.
JGX in the studio audience this evening.
Yeah, and we're here today. We're here today because of her graciousness and her introductions. Like I said, I really value the journey. Thank you, Jennifer.
Yep, thanks, Jennifer. She got the shades just for this.
Hey, if Dr. Normal can wear his shades,
Dr. Normal has his on too.
It's okay.
That was good. We should all been ready with our shades for after hours.
I lost mine a couple years ago, and I haven't found them yet. So.
Put her on the Doc Normal cam.
Does she have her own lower third? Or
no, it's the Doc Normal cam.
I'm just saying, if I were switching, you'd have your own lower third. It's the kind of girl I am.
It's a lot of work.
Yeah.
Yeah, the typing of it's hard stuff. Okay.
I thought you were going to ask about the connection between musicians and developers.
I am. Target. I'm about to.
Okay.
I'm getting there because we've had more than one person on the show that is both deeply ingrained in the tech industry.
Right.
And in the music. And actually, one of my favorite examples is someone, I always see someone making a living in the tech industry and then doing music on the side. That's what I see far more frequently. But one of our favorite guests, who actually recorded the intro music for our After Hours episode, makes a living as a musician and dabbles in tech.
On the side, yeah.
Well, I think that confirms the creativity, you know, across all.
He's an insanely creative individual.
You know, across all industry. You know,
hi, John.
That really illustrates it right to a point.
Look how I wave at my microphone when I say hi.
Seemingly unrelated that are related.
Yeah, they definitely are.
Yeah.
And it's, you know, I think it is, I don't know if you actually is writing code, but there is something about, and I'm sure there's scientific articles on this, but I think there's something about the use of the brain. And I mean, music is mathematics, you know, there's a basis in mathematics and coding, there's a basis in mathematics in a way. So it makes sense. I mean, there's something in the between the interaction of right and left brain that I think those two make sense together. I know for me it did. So
from now on, when someone asks me why I can't play an instrument, I'm going to tell them it's because I can't write code. It'll explain everything.
I can't
write code and I can't play a musical instrument, so it must be somehow related. I don't have the gene.
There you go.
So how did you start playing music?
I started...
and what you tell them what you play.
Yeah, so I play the 5-string banjo, which was the first, and then after that it was guitar and bass and mandolin.
Mm-hmm. Can you do an interstitial for us at the conference?
Do a little show? So the banjo is the harder of those, so it's kind of nice because I started with the hardest one I found later. But it was very vivid. I was in seventh grade, and our choir teacher also had a folk ensemble. So he did this on his, I think he got paid a little stipend, but mostly it was his own time. He had you get together in the morning or after school, depending on the part of the year it is, folk ensemble, guitar, stand-up bass, banjo, mandolin, just a really valuable thing for the district. And he came in. They said next year I want to talk to you guys as a folk ensemble. See if anybody wants to start it next year. So he started. He did it near the end of seventh grade, mm-hmm. and he was talking about recruiting kids basically for eighth grade. And he played the banjo. He played one song, and I don't know. It's just one of those that happens to people who start musical instruments. Is they all of a sudden boom, something happens, and they decide I want to play that. So I walked up afterwards and I said, I don't want to wait till next year. I want to start now. So that was how I started playing the banjo. Yeah.
Very cool.
Yeah.
Hey, Dr. Normal, how did you start playing the drums?
Well, I was just going to ask, what instruments does Tad play?
You know, I don't play.
He can't.
I can't write code either.
He can't write code, exactly.
But, well, tell us what your creative outlet is.
Yes, let's talk about that.
I'm a filmmaker by trade, a producer.
Oh, nice.
So I am actually very inspired by the visual arts, the cinematography of a scene like in Shawshank Redemption, where Morgan Freeman goes to the rock wall to get the
that
little box, and there's
scene.
The beautiful oak tree and the rock wall, which the art department probably built, but I don't know. But anyway,
scene.
The point is that the beauty there, the beauty of visual, is what really inspires me. And of all the departments in film, you know, that's really what gets me. You know, when you see artwork for not just its value, but it's again the visual aspect of it. Mm-hmm. You know, that's what I do for creativity.
Tad has a very impressive CV in the video production world here in the region and
okay,
elsewhere.
Too many acronyms.
Yeah, yeah.
CV?
CV?
Curriculum.
Oh,
his
okay.
Resume.
Oh, yes, that thing.
For creatives.
Yes.
Why couldn't you
just
but I
want to
hear
the
Dr. Normal.
Yeah, he doesn't want to tell us. I want to know. Dr. Normal, how did you start playing the drums? How is that the instrument that you chose? He's also a composer, and I find it interesting that he's a drummer and a composer.
Oh, yeah. Phil Collins, wasn't it?
Yeah, okay.
You have to talk now.
Yeah, will you play our at-large Halloween party?
Sure.
All right. Great.
As long as it's not actually on Halloween.
Actually, it is on Halloween.
Oh, well, you'll have to talk to his agent.
And just so I say, they are one of our sponsors for the
party. Yeah, by the way, they're a sponsor. Yeah.
By the way.
So we hear the drum origin story.
Tell us how you started to play the drums, Dr.
It's just, you know.
No. Nope.
You're a kid. You want to play an instrument. Mm-hmm. You're all motivated. You know, the first the kids had the violin, and I was like, yeah, I want to get one. My parents were like, oh, we're not buying you a violin. You'll never play that thing. It's like, I want to play some music, you know. And so then when the band came around, I was like, trumpet's cool, sax. I was like, trumpet. And I told my parents when I left, I said, I'm picking trumpet, you know. And then I came home and I said, yeah, it was drums. Because it was like right when he goes, what do you want to play? And it's like, you know, everyone's like trumpet, clarinet, sax. And the guy got to me and I said, the drums.
It was you know, spontaneous.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay, all right.
Kind of keep
cool.
a rhythm, you
yeah.
know.
Yeah.
That's really an interesting story. No wonder I didn't know this.
Because no one else had said drums yet?
What's that?
No one else had taken drums yet? So you
no.
carved out your niche?
No.
That's what the banjo was just carving out a niche.
No you could be like, no one else
is playing.
There's no competition.
No one else in the room is playing the banjo.
It's my gig.
Yeah.
Well, the I don't know. Banjo's got like kind of a drum on it.
It does have a drum.
It's got like
you can
a little
definitely
percussiveness.
Tap. Yep, absolutely. It's got a drum head.
I don't know. It was a small school. The band program was small, so playing the snare drum was like probably they needed another clarinet player or whatever. You know, it was one of those things where it's like, you sure? It's like, yeah.
It's a way to get the girls.
Yeah, and then about a year later, I was told
that was
I sucked.
That was useful for him.
You know?
It was. You were told that you sucked.
Oh, yeah.
You got better.
I got better.
Yeah.
I worked at it. Is that? Did you have to work hard at music?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
It was, and I these moments, I still remember the day I was playing one song over and over and driving my parents crazy. I couldn't get it. And all of a sudden, one day, I got it. I just remember this very vividly. It was like, I got it, and I did it. I did it again and again, and from that day, I just progressed. But it was like months of trying to do one song the right way.
I think like every instrument's like that.
Yeah, see, I played the recorder for a week because they made me in elementary
right.
school.
Yep. It's one of those, yep, yep. yep.
And no, that didn't go well. And then I also played the piano by ear when I was little, but then when my grandmother decided I needed to take piano lessons,
right.
I could no longer play the piano. I was like, okay. Yeah, I could play Somewhere Over the Rainbow. That's cool. Rainbow Connection. No, I played Rainbow Connection. That was the only thing I could play on the piano.
Similar complexity to Somewhere Over the Rainbow.
Yeah. I'd say the disadvantage is that when you play the drums, you're the guy with the best rhythm, but when you want to do songwriting and stuff, now it's like, now what's this harmony again? Yeah. You know, what's this all about? So you have to learn all of those things. So when I went to college and, you know, we're doing theory and, you know, and composing and arranging and stuff, I was the guy that had the best rhythmic pieces. And I mean, I was writing in seven and all sorts of stuff. Right, and everyone else is a choir major and doing like 4/4 Hindemith harmony, you know. So actually the teacher sort of dug that. It's like, oh, at least I've got something to look at with some rhythm, you know, a little Bartok or something, you know.
You know, my least favorite thing about being married to a drummer.
There you go. Yeah.
You know,
my least favorite thing about being married to a drummer is when someone asks you, "Oh, your husband's a musician," and I say, "Yes," and they go, "What instrument does he play?" And I always, "He's a percussionist," and they're like, "What?" I'm like, "He's a drummer." And they're like, "Yeah, everybody thinks they're a drummer." I'm like, "No."
Yeah, everybody thinks they're a director too.
I'm always like, "No, he really actually is a musician. He just happens to play the drums." Yeah. They're like, "Yeah, whatever." That's fine. It's true.
That's fine.
Dr. Normal, it's very difficult.
I think you should be a director.
And doing the analysis
He's
on the Stravinsky and the Wagner and stuff. Trust me.
He made a movie and made me watch it once.
I think, drummer, director. Yeah. I think that has a nice sound to it.
Oh, it's hard to do really
I could be
well.
The next Phil Collins, right? You know, instead
Does
of
Phil Collins direct?
Being a singer. I don't know. He could. He's Phil Collins. Damn it. He can do
He's
anything.
Right.
He wants.
Phil Collins
anything.
Writes, too, doesn't he? Didn't he write some of those?
He was in A Hard Day's Night, little known fact.
Oh, is that right?
He was a little kid actor in England, and he has, like, a bit role. This is some piece of trivia
have amazing amounts of trivia.
And Phil Collins kind of made the drum... Tell me if you disagree with this. He kind of made the drum an instrument like on par with the others in pop music. I mean, that's really what was his, wasn't that?
Oh, yeah.
His contributions.
I agree. No, I mean, he was very...
He made being a drummer cool.
Right, yeah. Well, and bald being cool, too.
Yeah.
And the thing is if you go back, it was his Genesis, the stuff he did in Genesis, because it was like, you know, you always have these bands like, you can name them, right? Genesis, the Eagles, and the band?
Yep.
Is that the... There's like three I can think of where the drummer sings.
Yep.
I don't know what the band is. I know the Eagles.
Well, they were, you know...
Robbie Roberts.
Yeah, Robbie Roberts.
I don't know the band. It sounds
like
a television show.
Dylan and those guys.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah.
I am apparently ignorant.
But, I mean, you know, he made the drum... You know, like, you noticed the drums. Yeah. He added a whole new... Didn't he invent the gated snare? I mean, that was his...
Phil Collins did?
I think he was innovative. He did the gated snare. He was the first to do that.
He popularized
the snare. What's the difference between a gated snare and a regular snare?
Oh, jeez.
It's the gate shuts down.
Hey, if you don't want to speak English.
I'll tell you what the difference is. The 80s.
That's fair.
The 80s.
Spandex, lip gloss, and the gated snare.
Speaking of the 80s, we're still trying to figure out, was it Oh Lord or Hold On from In the Air Tonight? We had debate after debate over beers in college about that one.
So the gate shuts the sound off before the natural...
So it stops
resolution
it.
Of the... Okay. So it stops it while
it's just like putting your hand on it.
Yeah, it's an electronics effect, but yeah. I mean, is that fair?
Yeah.
So it would be on an electronic drum?
It's like turning up and down the volume knob really quickly while you presently are on a gate.
Aha! That way you don't go on for too long.
It's
an electronics effect.
Phil Collins, and he even got into like heavy metal, you know, Def Leppard and all that stuff. It was like...
Can we talk about Bon Jovi?
Bon Jovi.
I mean, Bon Jovi.
It was like, how big can you make that snare drum sound? Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, it sounds like, you know...
How about Crossroads?
Marching.
I have no idea.
Drum.
Yeah, that was a good one. Good compilation one. Runaway. Great song.
Oh, the album. I don't pay attention to the names of albums.
Yes, that one was had a
compilation. I really don't. I'm horrible.
Wanted Dead or Alive.
People, God.
Runaway.
You don't want to...
Bed of Roses.
You don't want to say any of these songs, though. If you say the song names, then I'll sing them, and I have promised not to sing on the show.
Runaway is a good, feel-good Bon Jovi song. You know, it's just one of those things. You know, you could be in a bad Minute, you put that one in, and damn, you feel good.
Ted, give us your favorite butt rock bands right now.
We're talking 80s. Was Def Leppard, definitely. Mm-hmm. Bon Jovi.
Yeah, bon Jovi, absolutely. Thank you.
No one we mentioned he's the only guy wearing a jacket, right? So it's always the guy wearing the jacket with the nice haircut that's like, oh, yeah, you know, Def Leppard.
Scorpion. You know, yeah, you bet. Classic rock. We have got this great set from the 80s. It's called Frat Rock. And we built it from the songs that we borrowed from Napster. We had permission, of course. But it was this great set that we put on, and it has all of those great 80s, you know, what we called frat rock, you know, and it was just good stuff. I don't know if Aldo Nova fits in there, too, but...
Oh, yeah.
I'll pull out a couple for you if you keep me going.
I was doing a little, you know, how you get on Twitter and it's late at night, you should be going to bed. And
that was a long night.
Someone said something, and it reminded me of the... I know that Aldo Nova song, like, they tweeted, and it was part of the thing, so I was, like... spamming Twitter with YouTube videos of Aldo Nova, and then it's like, oh, and back at you with the Scorpion, back at you with, you know, and I had a bunch of my followers going, keep going, yeah, we're loving this, you know, I was kind of doing
and his wife was like, shut up, stop it.
Def Leppard, you know, the whole crazy.
And I'll tell you what, if anybody needs that set, I'll, you know, just get a hold of me and I'll burn it on CD for you, all MP3s.
Oh,
and,
yeah.
You know, captured legally.
Because it would not be legal for me to accept that. I would say I'd like the list.
The list?
I'd like the list so that I could then legally acquire
them.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. We have the other 80s great stuff, too, not only the frat rock set, but the pre-dance. Post, yeah, all the good 80s.
You a big Duran fan?
Do you have a favorite butt rock band?
No,
I don't. No, it's not the kind of music I was listening to.
How about Mr. Mister? Either. That was the one.
No butt rock for JGX? All right. Well, I'm going to say my favorite butt rock band is a tie between Bon Jovi and Tokyo. And if you don't know who Tokyo is, that was Dr. Normal's band when he was pretty with long hair and lip gloss and spandex, and I never would have slept with him.
That's what you guys met.
Okay,
he's older than I am.
Oh, okay.
Yeah,
well,
no,
I was in that band.
So wait, did you get together? Did you get together while you was in the band?
No. He's 13 years older than I am. So when he was playing in the band, I was not old enough to appreciate men in lip gloss.
Oh, it's after hours. That's right. That's
it is after hours. I'm behaving.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Band stuff. Isn't that why all those guys joined bands or did? The ones that did?
Of course.
Absolutely.
Well, I mean, I was listening to jazz and all this really cool, like, musical stuff. And then, you know, I got my friend going, yeah, join a rock band. I'm thinking, I actually didn't like the music as well. I was listening to Mahavishnu Orchestra and Miles Davis and all this stuff and heavy fusion.
Could you sing a few lines from Beatles?
And I was like, well, I'm going to play this because I need a girlfriend. I mean, I'm like, I'm alone here. What am I going to do? Right? So,
jazz. Have you heard?
Dudes that cook and dudes in bands have girlfriends. That's what I think it is.
Yeah. I always
and then what about Rockstar? You remember that movie?
In bands.
Who was that?
That was a rule.
It was a rule. It was a hard and fast rule. I didn't date musicians.
Have you heard that?
They were irritating. Sorry, no offense to the musicians.
I can think of two bands you could have dated.
Yeah, but we
one
can...
was...
no.
What's their names? No, not... Not the ones you went to high school with.
No, yeah, I couldn't have dated the ones in high school. You're thinking of the other ones.
Yeah, but Green Day. Green Day.
It's creepy because we used to throw empty beer cups at them and at keggers, and then they would come into Lions where we would hang out and drink our coffee late at night, and they'd be like, oh, like,
you said
ladies.
Everybody hated them.
Didn't you throw a cup at me?
They used to suck a lot more. And, no, that you know, so many people threw empty beer cups. I mean, you would empty the beer cup first, except for me, because I didn't drink beer. But before you threw it.
You sure this wasn't Portland?
Portland, so the, California, whatever.
Not listen to this music, but Brad Paisley and Keith Urban have a song out called Start a Band.
Yeah,
there's a song called Start a Band. It's hilarious. You should, anybody who's actually started a band should listen to that one.
So that's interesting. I listen to old country music, but not new country music.
Is this like the scene in, what's the one with Billy Bob Thornton, the giant movie about the
Swing
guy?
Sling Blade?
No. With what's his name? We're going to start the band again. Yeah. I love that scene. They're just like, I've had, every musician has had rehearsals like that.
How many bands have you been in? How many movies have you made?
I'll let you guys go first on that one.
Me?
How many bands have you been in?
Not that many.
I can count like three.
Yeah, probably.
Is that accurate?
Well, here's the thing. I was doing like
sometimes.
You know, I was playing professionally, so I was playing in an orchestra or
not pickup gigs.
Cool. Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
Not pickup gigs. How many bands were you in?
I know, but the thing is when you're in a band, right, and all you're getting is free generic beer and maybe kind of a nasty.
Yeah, I'm not a nasty.
You're
PD.
Gonna go where you're gonna play My Fair Lady.
Correct. I'm not asking
writing a check.
What I'm asking you is how many bands you played in. How many musicals?
Should I answer?
Yes, you answer.
Four,
please.
Or five.
I think you stalled over there. So yeah, we'll have to.
Yeah, you guys go.
I've been in three.
Three.
And so one and in high school, and then in my high school. So I was in a bluegrass band. I played banjo. Mm-hmm. That's what you play when you're in flies in your banjo. It's bluegrass mostly, except for Bella Fleck. And
there you go.
At the same time, in parallel, and this has never happened in the history of my high school, there was a rock band. Mm-hmm. And so we were friends. And so we decided, one of our members from the bluegrass band went to college. And I'm like, why don't we like do bluegrass, you know, rock fusion? And so we got together with the rock band and played this gig.
I like it.
And the girls went crazy. And so we thought, well, let's do this full time. So that was my second band, was a sort of some members from the old band plus this rock band. And we did basically country rock. Mm-hmm. And it was very cool. Ooh. And then I looped back with my old bluegrass band and played with them for three more years. And then I did a band at U of O, little ensemble. So that was three total, but one was split.
So. What's the name of that? It's coming to me, that guitar player, and they had a band, and then he went off on solo, and he was like a bluegrass fusion jazz great guitar player too, and they did like Dixie, was it the name of the band, Dixie something, Dixie Dregs.
Oh, Dixie Dregs.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah.
That was amazing. Yeah. I mean, they were like playing like bluegrass jazz. Yep. Fusion.
Right. Yeah.
I don't know if Dr. Merle has the camera on him, but he was playing air banjo.
Air banjo over there.
So how about you?
Talk about the banjo story.
You've worked on a lot of productions.
I have worked on a lot of productions, and I'm not sure exactly, but I think it's 1,153 projects since I started.
Somewhere. I'm not sure exactly, but
I want to know, are these any you can talk about? Or?
Yeah, most of my stuff.
When you say he's done a lot of productions.
Dr. Normal, your mind always goes to a bad place.
I have, and you're right. Working at At-Large Films on Cooch Street, we did get a fair amount of, what kind of films do you make? You know, kind of inquiries.
Yeah,
and
large.
You know, we had a guy walk
Street.
Yeah, it's on Couch to the rest of the country. I didn't even say Cooch because I said what? And I said just
large
Couch.
Films on
it's
couch.
Just Couch Street, okay?
It's like Cooch? How do you spell that?
Yeah.
And, but we had a place on Sandy, and I kid you not, I thought somebody was playing a joke on us because this guy walked in straight out of the 70s with his polyester suit, and he said, and he was totally in character, and I thought somebody was playing a joke, cause this guy was so, but he was serious.
This was like Dirk Diggler, yeah. Boogie Nights.
Oh yeah, and for you listeners out there that don't know, apparently I was told that Portland used to be a very, very strong porn filming town, and that starts to make sense when you think about the strip clubs and all that.
The per capita. The adult theaters.
And by the way, I think that the high per capita of churches and strip clubs, it's really all the same people because we just don't have that many people.
Right.
But it's really the same people with their alter egos.
It
That's
is.
What I think.
It totally, totally
but,
has to be.
But yeah, most of our stuff has been.
Is it too cold to do that though? I mean, San Fernando Valley makes a lot more
too
sense.
Too cold for
right?
church? Or
outdoor
strip
scenes.
Clubs?
No, not too cold.
Oh, outdoor,
the
outdoor
scene.
Scenes. Outdoor
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
You're looking at it from a man's perspective. From a woman's perspective, things start to firm up and look
and
nice when you're
wouldn't
cold.
I?
I'm just saying.
We're degrading. So tell me about those commercials.
A lot of the commercial projects. Oh, yeah,
subject.
We're going to get back up to the here mainstream. But, but yeah, mostly commercial production work, Legacy, Taco Time, Providence. We've got a lot of strong health stuff on our background.
I'm sure these brands will enjoy this line.
Yeah, so I'm sure they would. But when you're in the commercial world, it's about that. But we've done some good, great trailers for, this project called Birdkeeper, which is still probably in scripting. Yeah, it's been a great journey over the year. A lot of infomercials, a lot of, you said Portland's a very strong infomercial town. Most folks know that. Documentary, independent films. But we've had, in that 14 or 15 years I've been doing production, I've been involved in almost every kind of project at some point or another.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, yeah, great, great dynamic people. And I'm still amazed at how many musicians, you know, are film people. You know, and how many people, how those industries do cross over.
Yeah, there's,
you know,
a lot of...
It's just amazing.
In all, I think, in all the creative industries, there's a lot of crossover.
Yeah.
It's like you were saying about the coding and the music. Mm-hmm. When you are a creative person, you kind of get in that mindset, and you just like to create things.
Right. Yep, yep. And it's just a matter of kind of the timing and the opportunities that might send you in one direction versus another. So that is interesting.
Yeah. Yeah, we touched a little bit on, you know, how strong that vertical is here. You know, software is about $8 billion in itself. You know, film's about $1.3 billion. You toss in ad, publishing, music, I mean, all that other. And we think roughly we're at, you know, I don't want to quote a figure, but it's got to be $14 or $15 billion. And manufacturing is about $15 to $25, depending on how you measure that. So we are a very, very strong industry in this state, and yet little people know that. Not many people know that.
Because, what do you think makes Oregon and Portland specifically such a good climate? It's like a petri dish on the West Coast. I mean, there are other places, but what do you think makes it such
a
good climate for the creative?
Well, it's the investment that the city has put into our quality of life. You know, they've worked on this for 40 years, and of course, the economic development strategies that are out have understood some lapses or some things that could be better with that. But the brain gain is because we have creatives that have come to Portland in the last minute or from the last day to about the last 5 years. Mm-hmm. They're really feeding that. They love it. They'll move here without jobs. You know, they're a huge creative.
I know.
And it's like feeding this whole new creative energy that we've got. It's phenomenal. You know, and that's part of the reason why Create Camp was doing so good, and you know, the conference is back, and everybody, because they just love talking about it.
Yeah.
So
yeah,
this is where I like to play the buzzkill.
Dr. Normal.
No, because
I started to talk about creative industries and starting to throw some $8 billion stuff. Yeah,
exactly.
Yeah, that was a buzzkill. Yeah,
people, you know where I'm going with
jobs.
This, right?
Maybe, yeah.
I mean, Steve, you're a native here too, as I am, and we've seen these kind of. Over the years, these, you know, kind of creative industries, a few, like one or two major films get shot in Oregon, and then, you know, Oregon's going to be the next, you know, Hollywood or something like that, and somebody's going to open
Vancouver,
a studio
BC,
or whatever.
There you go, that'd be nice.
Yeah. And then it kind of dries up and goes away, and then there's another cycle, and we're kind of in that cycle now. There's a lot of buzz about creative industries. So what do you see... both Tad and Steve, do you see a change coming now? With, is this the time it's really going to hit, or, you know, how do we go through that cycle?
Right. Do you want to?
Yeah, I'm thinking that went through a little bit. But yeah, how do we get through that? I think acknowledgement of what our strengths are.
Which
and weaknesses.
And weaknesses.
Yeah. What are our strengths versus Hollywood or Vancouver, BC, or any
it's
other
pretty
place?
Here.
Yeah, in the film industry, there's a lot of discussion about that. Locations are a big one. The ability of crew for not necessarily as deep as we have about three or four teams deep. You know, in our production, but for independence, it's just the environment, it's the people that are here. Ultimately, you need the resources to back that up, though, and a lot of things, the infrastructure to do that, and we're building that. The film office has been a great resource for us. It's also one of Ted Kulongowski's strong platforms. He's very supportive of the film industry. So when you start tying in the economic, the business side into that you've got to keep that momentum going, or else you'll lose track of it. And I think that's what our regional players have discovered, is that you cannot let economic development lapse, because when that lapses, of course, all the support goes away for that. Mm-hmm. So Oregonians, I think, personally are very good about ideas and creation, but sometimes we're not so great about making sure that we have that clear vision of where we want to be, because we lose track of it and we don't get there.
The business. So
if that helps answer that a little bit.
I mean, you know, part of the reason I wanted to, and I'm not the first person to talk about this, but this idea of this event cluster, sort of Portland's answer to South by Southwest, is because I'm very concerned about the sustainability of growing creative services and creative services talent and losing headquarter companies. Mm-hmm. The lack of Fortune 500 or even Fortune 1000 companies. So the clients, there's a shortage of clients and a oversupply of creative services.
Yeah.
And that's, you know, I'm concerned about that, the sustainability of that model for us as a region. So part of the thinking is, you know, it's just one of many potential solutions or one way to help is to bring more clients here and to have them network with creative services and have position the region as a hub. Mm-hmm. So, you know, the Richard, Florida. And
so people are coming in just for our talent?
Yeah, they're coming in just for the talent. So we get on the short list. Mm-hmm. I mean, this is some people think this is a total pipe dream, blue sky. But, I mean, if somebody doesn't start, then how are we going to get there? So the world is flat, this concept of metro areas becoming hubs for known specialties.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, what can we become a hub for? You know, some sort of this hybrid of tech and creative. And get on the short list. I mean, if you're thinking of creative services, it's like, well, maybe we better talk to someone in Portland. Mm-hmm. Let's get on the list at least.
Yeah.
I don't know who that is, but they have some great stuff going. So Oregon Creative Industries, part of what we talked about when we co-founded that is how do we make that more, how do we make that easier for these outside clients to come in and find somebody, whether that's a directory of services that's mm-hmm. comprehensive, events, just this outreach, this strategic outreach like we've done with the green industry here, like the road, you know, they built this 18-wheeler, I think, that went around telling our sustainability story and our mm-hmm. green building story.
Yeah.
So we think there's some proactive steps to take to help make that happen. But to answer the previous question, I mean, you know, what I've heard thematically over the last couple of years, 3 or 4 years, is people here don't think big enough. And so I think you combine that with the sense that, like you said, they're moving here, you guys, you know, without a job.
Yeah.
We have a lot of people who money is not their primary motivator.
Correct.
Okay, so
it's the field, it's
right.
the growth, it's
the lifestyle,
industry, it's what they can do from here.
Right. So if you have a lack of big ideas and a lack of motivation to make it a sustainable business, then you get this what Dr. Normal was talking about, this starting and stopping, this effort to do something, and then next thing you know, it's not there anymore. Where did those people go? Where did that effort go? And so we have lost, I think, opportunities, and I think that this event cluster, the concepts behind Oregon Creative Industries, if the rest of the community doesn't get behind that, it will mm-hmm. be another one of those things, frankly, that was like a good idea, we worked on it for a while, but no one ever saw it through, either from the public mm-hmm. or private side. And it takes all those to get together and make it happen. So that's what we're trying to do. And I do think, again, to answer part of the question, we do see momentum that we haven't seen for maybe 10 years or something.
Yeah, easily.
And so it's a matter of capturing that momentum and putting an infrastructure in place to keep it going so it survives any one person. I mean, I've already kind of backed out a bit, right?
Yeah.
I'm still helping, but luckily Tad's been keeping that going. And so that's why I think we have struggles. So we need some more entrepreneurial leadership that will recognize there's got to be a business model with this good idea and all these great people to sustain it.
And branding, you know, Portland, continue to brand Portland as a destination, you know, around the world mm-hmm. for creative problem-solving solutions. You know, and that's important. And of course, I think the city and the state has come, in the first time in 15 years, I see a plan that they have put together where we have ideology matches across all sectors,
mm-hmm.
you know, to help us get to this place where we think we want to be, the most sustainable city in the world. So that'll all help too, if we can actually actualize that over the years.
I find it incredibly fascinating that you talked about earlier the Portland Creative Tech hybrid, kind of the technology and creative working together. We've talked on the show before about the startup scene, the tech startup scene, and how it's not a lack of talent that is a problem for us. We have a glut of talent.
Mm-hmm.
What we have is a lack of people to streamline that, to run it, to run the business side of it. And
it
sounds like
business operations. And so
we're lacking business talent, not creative talent, not tech talent.
Yeah, we are. And because the business talent, the people that know how to run the business, I mean, there's certainly a lot of them here, but some of those superstars, they can start that business and grow it
mm-hmm.
and attract VC.
Mm-hmm.
They know VC doesn't come in here, so they go north or south. Typically, and so it's a bit of a challenge. Yep, absolutely.
Yeah.
I just think there are so many parallels between the creative community and the tech community, and every time you recognize more and more of them, it speaks to Portland's talent in both those fields. And then when you look further into it and you see the people, having had a lot of people on our show and talked to a lot of people in the tech community, and realizing how many of them went to the Art Institute, how many of them are looking for careers in film or in advertising or in music. It just seems that it all meshes together really,
it does,
really well.
But, you know, I want to, you know, I think for your audience, I do want to point out something specific that that I've challenged some of the young technical folks with, and I'm not always popular because of this, but there is a bit of lack of understanding of the value of collaboration with outside that circle. And so I've actually, you know, it's been a bit of a struggle, frankly, to, like, for example, Legion of Tech is the only vertical association that hasn't really signed on with something like, let's help promote this other event. So they, by charter, have said we're only going to promote our own events. Every other association promotes, it cross-promotes each other's events.
And I wonder if some of that is because they have, one of their guidelines is that they do not ever charge for an event.
Right.
There's and I think that might be.
It stems from that, and so I, you know, Steve Woodward, he used to write for the Oregonian, and so I was.
We've had Steve on the couch.
Yeah, I was at coffee with Steve Woodward, and he said, "Well, what are you really trying to do?" And I got a napkin out, and I wrote I drew a quadrant, and I said, "Creative, tech." New generation, old generation, and I said, I think if Portland's really going to reach its potential, we have to meet in the middle and help each other out. And so that's really what I'm trying to do. And so out of that quadrant, the most resistance has come from new generation tech as far as collaboration.
Which I think is fascinating because they're all very, very able to collaborate amongst themselves.
Amongst themselves. And it's been a wonderful thing for the community. But again, I'm not going to be popular for saying this, but it does need to be a bit of an opening up and recognition that all boats will rise with that tide. And so it's been a really good party. And so I think it's time to like open up and recognize that the value that both that all quadrants can add to each other to really help Portland get on the map in a way we all know it can, and the economic benefits of that, because that's really bottom line what we're talking about is getting money flowing through the system.
And how can all the verticals really truly help each other and get past that bubble that they are in? And just about 10% of the time to reach out to the other associations and the other community participants, you know, to really help us towards that bigger vision. You don't have to lose your identity or anything like that. Again, strong verticals make for extremely strong building. And I could give you my Parthenon example of how those columns are part of the Parthenon. You know, and you've got very, very strong columns of this here, but they're not so strong this way without the connectivity of that. You know, and so we're building a Parthenon with that has that. That's a true building in each one of those verticals, but in a small sense, we as a community have to get past that little inherent nature that we're the best, you know, and that everybody is the best because that's what makes true creatives. We know we're good at it, you know, but get past that little inherent nature and just collaborate a little bit with the other ones on certain things so we can be a truly united, you know, industry like some of the other big industries in the state. Again, if we're talking economic development, that's what we have to do to keep ourselves organized. Get us all these cats, frogs, and squirrels together, you know, and just for a little bit and help us do that. And we're very close to doing that.
And other regions get it. You know, so you look at, Tad mentioned case study in London. Obviously, Austin has their act together. That's why if you look at Greenlight Greater Portland's economic benchmark data, their prosperity index, Austin is a city that Portlanders identify with. We see a lot of similarities.
So they've got a little sister city.
But if you look at the 8 comparable cities, which include Austin, Austin is kicking our butt in every category. And one of the reasons they are is because they've got their act together. Tad's been there.
You've just pissed off a whole lot of Portlanders.
Well, I'm sorry. And, you know,
okay.
So we have a South by Southwest party in Portland, and the South by Southwest Corp is laughing all the way to the bank, frankly. And we all talk about, great, all the people going to South, but what they don't realize is they're feeding a competing economy because we're competing for those same jobs. and we're competing for those same outside resources, venture capital, clients. So I think that's what we have to realize. It doesn't mean we can't all get along. But then you look at Philadelphia, and Tad's been to Philadelphia as well. If you wanna...
In fact, two of our case studies in Austin, I met with a gentleman that they hired in 2002 to fix their whole economic development problems. I met the guy, and very humble man, but he came in from Nashville and a couple other areas to solve this problem that Central Texas had. So I had a chance to meet with him and their creative liaison from the city when I was there, two very key people for the creative economy. So I go to Philadelphia and I meet with the president of Innovation Philadelphia, which is the group that we believe is what our old alliance would be, because we used to have a group like ours, what it would be today had it not dissolved. So I met with that president and also the other key person with the city and the creative economy. Right, and so these things, as I bring back this information of, well, what can we do here, and they kind of got some things that they're figuring out. The rest of the world calls calls us creative industries. We still have that definition of creative services, which is a subset of that, along with nonprofits. But again, so we get into that very, very strong case studies with the UK of what these folks are doing on those efforts, to back up what you're saying.
Yeah, Innovation Philadelphia has been around, and I mean, they have venture, they have funds, they have funding, they have professional development, they have events. I mean, when I met with the creative economy lead for the state of Massachusetts, he just had gotten hired by the governor. He was the first state-level governor direct appointee in the nation to focus on the creative economy sector, and I told him what we were doing, and he's the one who put us on to Innovation Philadelphia as the one place he's seen that's really doing it right. So we still have a chance to be at the forefront. It's not like every city in that economic index that we're competing with, but ours has this figured out.
Because at least we are competing.
Yeah, and by the way, Portland was a very, very, very strong pioneer in all this back in with Vera in the mid-90s and 1998 itself. Mm-hmm. When this whole thing got going, we were on the same line with the UK with how we would define our whole industry.
We just slowed down.
We let it fall. Les Prentice passed away from PDC, and he was a big driver of the funding. I mean, there's about eight strong reasons why this could have been still.
You really do like the number eight.
Exactly. And when you get back to the audience in Austin, and as great as Austin is, they're so interested in talking to us because we've got some serious things figured out that they don't.
Yeah.
And I love that balance between sister cities because again, we just go and learn. And Mike Rollins, the gentleman at Austin, was fortunate. I mean, he was very interested in sharing that collaborative stuff because we can help each other out.
Yeah.
Austin is a great city, great music scene and all that, as is Philadelphia when you get into the creative stuff. But again, you start learning. Portland is a kick-ass city.
Yeah.
It can be a great place. As well as we continue.
But yet, to the economic. Leading the nation in unemployment. I mean, there's things that aren't working, and I think we have to recognize they aren't working. Yeah. People should look at that Green Light Greater Portland. I think it's greenlightgreaterportland.org.
I think so.
They just published their latest survey, and you can just see in all these economic, job growth. Industry growth, et cetera. Austin has and is predicted to just beat our pants off.
Yeah.
And they shouldn't. I mean, we should be more at parity. And it's because we think we don't quite have our act all together, and we're not all united.
So let me take it back a tick because we got to wrap it up soon. But we were talking earlier about the quadrant when you were talking to Steve Woodward, when we have the old school, new school, and the tech and creative.
Right. Yep.
And you said that the young creatives, the new creatives are the ones, or I'm sorry, the new tech are the ones having a hard time. But Brahm has, I mean, how did you get involved with Brahm in the first place? Because Brahm's a good example of someone who bridges the gap between those two things.
Yeah, so Create Camp, which is an unconference for creatives, for creative industries, basically the genesis of that is I wanted to tell the creative conference story to new creatives in Portland that weren't here during the original run.
Okay.
So we had two audiences.
Because a lot of our creatives are very young.
They're young and new, so they never heard of it. So I said, how can I introduce the concept of the creative conference to the younger creatives in town? So I came up with Create Camp. Mm-hmm. I thought, well, I'm on this side of the line. I'm on the older side of the line. I need someone on the other side of the line to partner with on Create Camp. And Brahm had done a blog post where he said, I just went to bar camp and I'd like to do one of these for my creative friends. So I saw that and I'm like, oh, here's my partner. So I contacted him and I said, I want to do a bar camp for creatives. and I'd like you to partner with me. And so he had that credibility with that part of the, you know, that younger, the younger mm-hmm. generation that I didn't have yet. And so that's how that happened. So it's a very conscious effort to reach across that gap and partner such that we would have everybody together. So that's, and I've reached across the tech gap as well quite a bit. And it's just been, like I said, just more difficult to make a true connection. And I've said this to the Legion of Tech board. And and so, again, I'll keep saying it until I think something changes, even though that may not make me popular there.
Just keep saying it until you're blue in the face.
Yeah. That's right. And Brom's killer. He's a good dude, too. So.
Yeah, he is.
And he's very good guy. Yeah, Brom, if you're listening, right on.
Hi, Brom. Probably is.
Yeah.
So the last question I had was, Austin's beating her pants off. Do they have the same mesh of tech and creative that we're trying to achieve? Are they just doing that particular?
They do. They're almost across the board as far as an economic development strategy. Their five clusters pretty much make up the same as our four, mm-hmm. except they have one called creative media, mm-hmm. which encompasses TV, radio, film, gaming. All right. And so, you know, we've approached the city on that aspect of it because they are definitely 100% going after the creative media ballgame. They're demonstrating by their actions that they want to be in that game. And they have a film incentive that they just passed, which is $60 million. And understand the scale, because their state budget is $178 billion versus ours, which is about 17 to 14, depending where it landed. All right, so they are definitely making a play for this, but there's a lot of things that they don't have to offer that we do. Okay, we just have to regroup ourselves and make sure that we can go head to head with that.
Yeah,
you know, because they are, of all the cities, probably the most equal one I know that are in the same category as us. You know, other than the big primary markets, LA, New York, Chicago, Philadelphia.
So, do you think their talent makes us more competitive? Does it make us want to do better, or do people just go, "Oh, they've got it"? I mean, what's the competitive feeling like? I mean, you got sports teams, and yeah, they want to compete, but what's the competitive level in the creative industries? Is there that strong drive to do better than everyone else?
I don't
have an immediate impression on the answer to that one.
I think it starts with recognizing that we are competing mm-hmm. for dollars, talent, resources. Client jobs. I mean, we are competing with centers like Austin and probably even Philadelphia. Yeah. And these regions that get it and get their act together and have a strategic plan are the ones that I think are winning and that will win. So we had kind of presented, Oregon Creative Industries had kind of presented, after all this research and talking to the community through these roundtables and a lot of other meetings, this sort of draft plan for the Oregon creative economy. So we're still working through with the city, and Tad's doing a lot of work there still. We see some momentum gathering from those initial seeds, and so that's what's been. And we're kind of using the creative conference as a bit of a gathering place and a lightning rod to energize some activity post conference. Yeah,
the conference is a great element. It's a gluing element that will hold mm-hmm. the creative industries together year after year on something common, you know, as we reach these goals. Mm-hmm. You know, so that's a beautiful match, you know.
So before we wrap up, each one of you, if you could just have one thing that you'd want to see in the next year for the Portland creative community, what would it be?
So for me, it's like, you know, pulling off the conference and making it sustainable, mm-hmm. and then getting behind Oregon Creative Industries as a trade association of verticals, and, you know, endorsing a plan that the community is behind.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, mine is, that one, it just took me a second to think about it, but it's crystal clear to me. Creative ecosystem alignment, mm-hmm. right, across all creative economy participants, both profit, for-profit and non-profit. Mm-hmm. That's the stuff we have to do, you know, to move forward. It's working with the city and regional creative action plan. Mm-hmm. It's working for all the for-profit verticals, getting us together as an ecosystem to understand that we're all part of that whole element that's really going to truly brand us, you know, and give us the competitive edge that we can use in other markets.
All right.
I think it's crystal clear for me. Thank you.
Tad, Steve, thank you guys so much for joining us.
Yeah,
it was a pleasure.
Yeah.
Good night, everybody.
Thank you. Thank you.
Mm-hmm.